Hello, I'm Brian Boring, and welcome to the final segment of the Distinguished Lecture Series entitled Listening to the Prairie. This piece features distinguished lecturer David Behm. Mr. Behm is Executive Director of the Connemara Conservancy. Mr. Behm has been directly involved in multiple efforts assisting private landowners to conserve open space on their family lands and helps to facilitate the transfer of other lands for public use throughout a 33-county area in and around Dallas. Mr. Behm initiated transactions to conserve nearly 20,000 acres of environmentally sensitive open space. He also organized and presented at a land conservation workshop for North Central Texas land trust, landowners, and cooperating agencies and organizations. So let's join Mr. Behm as he lectures on conservation easements, conserving space on private lands.
Seriously, we really do want to acknowledge the vision of Francis Williams, who unfortunately passed away about a month ago. And it really was her vision that did two things. One, and who knows, it's really not worth debating which is more important, because they both are very important. One was to give the gift of 72 acres to the residents and visitors to North Central Texas of the Connemara Meadow. And the other was to be a co-founder of creating the organization that is known as the Connemara Conservancy. And what I'm going to talk about tonight is really one of the aspects that, as Tom alluded to, we're really gearing up for, and that is becoming a regional land trust organization. I'll define what that is in just a moment. And to hopefully do justice to Francis's vision for the future, which was to conserve open space, and really its natural setting, and for its own intrinsic values. And some of those I'll touch on as well. But I do want to emphasize that the organization is much more than 72 acres, but the 72 acres is a perfect illustration of what we want to try and protect throughout all of North Central Texas. Eric, how are we doing?
We've got about a 2-minute slow boot up here, but we need to get the city some new equipment.
Okay. Okay. Well, that's fine. I'll probably just start talking here. Does everyone have an opportunity to pick up one of these? It's probably very important if you want to jot down notes or doodle. I'm rather robust around the waist, so I don't make a very good stick figure if you want to doodle. But I was going to say that if you could pick up one of those, that really will hit all of the major points I'm going to make tonight about conservation easements. And a couple things as we're waiting for the slides to catch up is that one thing that you need to know about, and Scott, am I in your periphery here? All right. One thing you need to know about is something called a land trust. A land trust is basically a nonprofit organization based in the community with community leaders like yourselves, like Wilma, that really has a passion for conserving open space. Now, there are land trusts that have various niche interests, like the Nature Conservancy. They're interested in preserving open space that happens to be habitat for rare, threatened, and endangered species. Gentleman in the back mentioned the Natural Area Preservation Association. Kind of their name says it, although they're certainly broadening their scope. And an organization like Connemara Conservancy, you really can't glean a whole lot from its name, perhaps, because it's not tied to North Central Texas or a type of land. But really what we're about is conserving open space in its kind of its broadest sense. Because open space, which is nothing more than undeveloped land, has many public values. Even, as Eddie very appropriately pointed out, it's privately owned. 95% of the state of Texas is privately owned. And that's probably not going to change very significantly, if at all, in the future. It goes back to the heritage of the state. And as you can tell by my lack of y'alls and some other things, I'm not a native Texan. Have been living now in Texas for about 7 years, the last 14 months here in Allen, actually. My wife and I live in town. Prior to that, my background and my accent comes from the great state of cheese, Wisconsin, and also in working in Minnesota. And most of my 20-year career has actually been working for and with agencies like the one that employs Eddie. I've worked with local and state agencies in soil and water resources management. And now I'm working for the nonprofit sector. And so most of what you're going to hear from me tonight is going to be different from what Eddie said, because I'm not going to be at all bashful about showing you some of my biases. I'm not going to be at all bashful about sharing some of the things why I think it should be important to you. I'll let you make the decision, of course. I'm not that presumptuous. But I'm not going to be bashful about sharing some of the things that I think you need to be concerned about. Well, back about land trusts. They're, again, a nonprofit organization that works to conserve open space. Conemaugh Conservancy is one that looks at 33 counties in north central Texas. To give you a real quick geographic perspective, we go from basically Wichita Falls in the northwest over to the city of Paris in the northeast. And if you could imagine a line running east and west through roughly the city of Corsicana, and just kind of imagine a block of counties. That's the part of north central Texas that Conemaugh Conservancy is addressing. We are positioning ourselves to become a regional land trust. We want to conserve open space throughout this area. And the two ways we're going to do that is to work with communities like the City of Allen, the City of Plano, counties, and even the state government where it may be appropriate, to provide public areas for recreation, education, wildlife habitat, nature preserves, those types of things. But probably primarily what we're going to do is we're going to work with private landowners and to conserve open space through something called a conservation easement. And I'm very excited about that, especially as being a relative newcomer to the state of Texas, because I see the state of Texas as being a tremendous land of opportunity. And I don't want to sound like a carpetbagger. I've been called that actually by one of my former board members in Houston. But I know that she was saying that with the greatest of love and respect. But my point is that I see tremendous opportunity because of that 95% private ownership and that strong heritage of private ownership. Because one of the things that's very clear in the 20 years of working with private landowners in three states is that private landowners are the best stewards of property, bar none. And don't let anyone kid you otherwise. If I could have the next slide, please. What I'll be talking about is conservation easements. Conservation easements, when it's all said and done, is simply this. It's a legal agreement with two parties, somebody that gives up development rights and someone who has the legal authority to enforce that that agreement stays put on that piece of property forever. Sounds fairly ominous, I don't mean to be, but I want to impress upon you it's very serious. It's a real estate transaction that essentially lasts forever, and it's tied to that piece of land. It's not tied to that person. The person that created the easement truly is responsible for that and does it, as we'll get into it a little bit later, for very personal reasons. But the beauty, if you look at it that way, of a conservation easement is that it lasts well beyond that person's lifetime. And that's what gets back into this heritage of preserving a heritage of open space and why it's so important. A conservation easement is really based in law in two ways. One, in the state of Texas, the enabling statute is Chapter 183 of the Natural Resources Code. I would encourage you to take a look in the annotated statutes and read it. It's only about 4 pages long. In fact, I would even go so far as to encourage you to photocopy it and take it home with you. And see if you can, as you crawl in your comfortable bed, see if you can get through the 4 pages without falling asleep. And I'd be willing to bet you that probably everyone in this room, maybe not immediately following my presentation, but on another night, almost everyone in this room could probably do it. The reason is it's actually an interesting law because, number one, it provides tremendous flexibility, and number two, it doesn't go into a whole lot of legalese. And as a former bureaucrat, I love those kinds of laws because it gives us opportunity to be creative at the local level, which is where land conservation is where it really takes place. So when you look at the variety of purposes and the types of lands that can be protected with conservation easement, you begin to understand just how powerful of a tool this can be and why it's so exciting, because it actually enables and empowers private landowners to protect their heritage. It enables private landowners to protect a heritage of a community that maybe several generations of their family have been a part of. So conservation easements, from my perspective, is very compatible with those people that espouse private property rights. It's one and the same. And when someone tells me, yeah, but you're doing this forever and you're gonna prevent those people from, those poor people that are gonna own it in the future from developing it, well, I like to remind them, when that same person decides to sell it to a developer and they put it under concrete homes, what options you got for the future? You'll never grow another crop of agricultural crop on it. You'll never be able to graze another animal on it. You probably won't be able to create a park out of it. How many options have you left those people in the future? So let's talk about reserving options, because a conservation easement, unlike a strip mall, is something that could be amended to allow for some other uses. And there is even the, although unlikely, chance it could actually even be extinguished. And so for those people who really say, yeah, but you know, you're going to be doing all this thing for the future, what if it were extinguished for a better public use? Again, reserving options. So if you look at conservation purposes under this, natural, scenic areas, availability for agricultural lands, what Eddie was talking about, protection of natural resources, that's pretty broad. And I couldn't agree more with one of his comments in his presentation about water quality. That is definitely going to become one of the key issues, certainly in the next decade, primarily from a standpoint of positioning ourselves collectively as a society and individually as private landowners, of doing the right thing for the future. Because it's one thing about talking about quantity of water, which is extraordinarily important, but what good is it if it's undrinkable? And again, if you look at the area that provides the tap water that comes out of our taps in the city of Allen and throughout the Metroplex, it's not coming from your next door neighbor's lot. It's coming from the rural areas surrounding these cities. That's why I don't care if you live in the 15th story of an apartment house, you had better be interested in what goes on in rural lands. You had better want to support one of those organizations, preferably Connemara. You had better want to get involved in organizations like Connemara. Become a trustee, become a committee member. Again, we would love to have your checks and cash coming in, but there's many other ways to get involved. The reason I say this is because it's things like protecting the watersheds of major river systems, which have the reservoirs that hold the drinking water that's going to get piped across Collin County to the city of Irving. That's why it's relevant to the people living in Irving. And it's going on in Collin County and Hunt County. Where do those people live? It's neither one of those. So that's why you need to think regionally, globally, act locally. That's just one example. Air quality is going to be the same thing. We get up in the morning in Allen, walk outside and say, oh God, what a great day. And we look to the south and say, gosh, I'm glad I don't live there. Well, guess what? We're still part of the problem. We're still going to be part of the solution. Conservation easements, in my opinion, even can be relevant in an urban setting to help with air quality issues. How? I'll tell you about that in another time. Historical, architectural, archaeological, all, again, are relevant conservation purposes. Next slide. And you'll see the overlap with this in the federal tax code, which provides the financial benefit or incentive to private landowners who choose to do this. And what's interesting is that you see the overlap with the prior slide, and that each one of these purposes for land protection, protecting open space, is tax deductible. Outdoor recreation by the general public. That is the only one, outdoor recreation by the general public, education of the general public. Those are the only two that will require at least some degree of inviting the public onto private land. There is no other conservation purpose of all the ones that are listed up there that require public access on private lands. And so one of the things I like to immediately dispel, if people get hyper concerned about this talk about private property rights, is that no, when you give a conservation easement, you're not allowing the public to come onto your property In fact, there's an overwhelming majority of conservation easements. Now, if I believe I'm right, somewhere around 10,000 across the country held by private nonprofit organizations like Connemara Conservancy. An overwhelming majority of those have nothing to do with public access. Public access is only relevant in the conservation easement when it relates to its public purpose. So if the public isn't recreating on your property, if they're not being educated on your property, they have no business on your property. Pretty much the same way it is with the land that you own right now. So looking at wildlife habitat, looking at scenic enjoyment, well, scenic enjoyment of the general public does not mean the public has the access to your property, not physical access. They have the visual access, looking across your property, assuming your property is in fact the one that's deemed to be scenic. And it's not important that you think it's scenic. It's not important that I think it's scenic. Some unit of government, federal, state, or local, has to say it's scenic. Now, I say that not tongue-in-cheek. I say that very sincerely. And so one of the things that you can do as a voter, as a citizen, is to impress upon your legislators, be them local, state, or federal, of just how beautiful North Central Texas is, and how scenic it is, and how that scenic value, like wildflowers, for example, like bird watching associated with that, all are economic importance to the area. And why, if those private lands are protected because of their scenic values, will continue to sustain those types of industries. And if you can work with private landowners to give a conservation easement on those areas designated to be scenic, they can get a tax deduction. So that's how these things are all relevant to each and every one of us, even if you live in the 15th floor of an apartment in downtown Dallas. Open space pursuant to clearly delineated federal, state, or local governmental conservation policy. I had to read it to make sure I got every word. Even as a former bureaucrat, I have to chuckle when I read this one. But what's important about this is it doesn't matter what the policy is. As long as some unit of government has stated it is so, then it shall be so that it'll be a good purpose for a conservation easement to the extent that, again, whatever that conservation policy is, it will enable that private landowner, if they're interested in donating a conservation easement, to get a tax deduction. That is good public policy, folks. Historically important land areas. We're actually working on a conservation easement south of Dallas that's looking at exactly that. Next slide, please. The last part of this variety of conservation purposes is considering what does the law allow and what is the holder of that conservation easement, in other words, the land trust. What are they interested in? And as I said earlier, not every land trust is going to be interested in every conservation purpose. If your purpose, if your mission as an organization is rare, threatened, endangered species, it's probably not going to be a good match for you as a landowner to approach them and say, I'd like to have a trail across my property to link in with the public park system of my community. What do you think? Probably say, well, a 30-foot wide corridor across your property linking up to parks, none of which has any rare, endangered, or threatened species, probably isn't of much interest to us. Again, I say that because it's important that you understand as the landowner that us easement holders have a purpose in life as well. As fuzzy as that may be from time to sort out, we like to keep to that mission, which again, an organization like Connemara Conservancy, we're pretty broad in looking at things. So it'd be fairly easy to work with us on a wide variety of things related to each of those conservation purposes mentioned earlier. The landowner, the person who's going to be donating this conservation easement, and all of their heirs, living and yet born, they need to think about what's the future of this property? How do we want to use it? How do we want to restrict it? Because that's very important as it relates to the conservation purpose. It's very important about the kinds of prohibitions, restrictions, and reserve rights that you'll put into your easement. And I'll get into that in just a moment. Next slide, please. Flexibility, probably more than anything else about conservation easements, is what makes them such a powerful land preservation tool, open space preservation tool, I should say. And flexibility is what makes it so attractive for landowners because they can come up with all sorts of what-if scenarios and we can probably address them. It's, again, depending on the kinds of easement holder that you work with. So the flexibility looks at kind of three major areas, the extent, the scope, and timing. The extent is, do I want to have an easement over the entire property or only a portion of it? It may make sense to put an easement only on a portion of it because you and your heirs have decided, or maybe your heirs have decided for you, that some of that property, yes, mom and dad, is in fact going to be developed, because that's how we want to put our kids get on board through college. And so they may want to put an easement on the area that the family agrees is the most cherished, is the most environmentally sensitive. Or you can put the easement on the entire thing, which leads me to my next issue of kind of the scope, is degree of restrictions. A conservation easement is not a cookie cutter template of restrictions that applies across every square inch the same. You can have one conservation easement that addresses one piece of property that may have five different zones of varying degrees of restrictions. You tailor the document to the land, you tailor the document to the individual landowner. And that leads me to the timing. When the landowner decides to do a conservation easement, they may decide that they want to do a one-time gift, to be done with it, to know how they're going to proceed, or they may decide to do it in phases. Easement holder like ourselves would probably be less interested in doing phases, only from the standpoint it complicates the relationship that we have with those future landowners. But like any good easement holder, we'll certainly consider that because we're more important in conserving the open space. Why a landowner would want to do phases is probably going to be tied to trying to maximize that tax advantages. And I'll begin to that in just a moment. If you're following along, we're at the bottom of the first page of the handout. And if I could have the next slide, please. The examples of some of these rural lands, and again, I don't care if you've never been out in the country, you need to think about these because they all come back and affect you in the city. Next slide. Family farms and ranches that Eddie talked about provide a wide variety of benefits to us city folk. I've always lived in the city. I'm one of those people that's one generation removed from being a farmer. My dad grew up on a farm in Wisconsin. Yes, it was a dairy farm, of course. But the point is that we're becoming a very urbanized society, and more of us have less and less contacts and connections with the land. And that's why more and more of us need to think about, even if we don't own it, even if we don't walk on it, why is it still relevant? And frankly, I don't buy it that it's up to others to educate us. I think it's your responsibility. So I appreciate you coming tonight. Farms and ranches are very important because they provide a wide variety of things, not just food and fiber. They also provide wildlife habitat that gives you the opportunity to look at something through your binoculars on the weekend as you drive your SUV along the county roads. It also provides you an opportunity of not having your 15th floor apartment submerged in the next flood because this area is retaining the floodwaters rather than channeling them through some concrete lined or straightened ditch, hurrying their way to your near city. Very important values here that are relevant to all of us. Next slide, the wildlife habitat. Probably is something more we can relate to. A wetland area, native prairie, a little stream corridor in the back, something that would be fairly typical to find throughout a number of areas in north central Texas. And lastly, a scenic view shed. For those of you that have driven along the Red River to the north, next slide please, you can see there are definitely some scenic areas. But of course, the beauty is in the eye of the beholder. I think Eddie said that. And there are areas that many people believe are very beautiful that are simply flat as this floor and in prairie grass, a sea of grass. So it's all an eye of the beholder, but I'm saying if a county or a community along the Red River said, we think that's scenic, we think that's important to preserve, rather than seeing rooftops, rather than seeing roads, rather than seeing a clear cut, then there's opportunities to do that. But you need to have the unit of government do the inventory and to say it's scenic. Otherwise, you don't empower that landowner to have a tax deduction, or even more importantly, a legitimate purpose for that conservation easement. We'd have to rely on other purposes. And on a hilltop like this, it's probably going to be limited to wildlife habitat. Next slide, please. If you remember nothing else, if you look at nothing else in my handout, please keep in mind the three key elements of a conservation easement: prohibitions, restrictions, reserve rights. Why this is so important is because when you clear away all the legalese of the document, what really matters to the landowner, what really matters to the easement holder, is what can and cannot be done on that piece of property. These three things all relate to land use. More importantly, these three things individually and collectively must be relevant to the conservation purpose that is selected for the conservation easement. Each of these three must also be consistent with preserving the conservation values that are unique to that piece of property and being consistent with preserving that conservation purpose. What do I mean by that? If you had a scenic easement, it wouldn't make a whole lot of sense to all of a sudden allow billboards or the building of structures right along the road, which is the visual access point for the people hurriedly driving to work or back home to view that beautiful scenic area. If you've blocked the view, there's no longer a scenic area there. So that's a real quick example. But the no-brainer prohibition on virtually every conservation easement that's ever been written is no industrial development, no commercial development. You will always see those. Now, you do not see a long list of prohibitions of land use on every single easement. It's because not all land uses are incompatible with the purpose of an easement, even if it's scenic. Next slide, please. Well, why on earth would any landowner in their right mind do this? Well, from my perspective, it gets to one of the first two motivations, both of which, as you can clearly tell, is very personal. People do this because they've made a decision that, number one, their enjoyment and use of the property has been tied to it being open and undeveloped, largely speaking. They have decided that their need, economic need of the property, is not to sell it off as a cash cow, not to sell it off and send the kids through college, not to send it off and do other things. They have addressed those needs in other ways. Or they decide, I had a rough life, the kids can too. Whatever the case might be. But what's very important and very serious about this is that either they have a strong heritage connection with the land, it's been the land's been the family for X number of generations, or they're looking at something that maybe they bought last week and they recognize that it's an important landscape of its own beauty, of its own inherent natural values. And that's why they want to see it protected for the future. That's why they want to have other people have the opportunity to enjoy it as they have in the future. There's really nothing selfish about that when you look at it that way. We move on to sense of empowerment. I think it's less of a motivation in and of itself, and to me it ties in with the first two. Because someone that has that strong of a personal connection with the land is going to get a sense of empowerment by knowing that this legal document is going to be recorded on the deed to that property and it's going to last forever. And that some organization is going to be charged with the responsibility of enforcing the very terms that you negotiated. That is where that sense of empowerment comes from. And lastly, financial. I will tell you over and over and over again, and I will willingly argue with anyone who tries to convince me that someone's going to do this for financial gain. Do the math. You put a conservation easement on a piece of property, you devalue it. There's no two ways about it. The only question is, how much have you devalued it? If you want to really devalue your property, you put on lots of prohibitions, lots of restrictions. My point here is that no one does this for financial gain. They've made the decision based on the first two. They have the satisfaction of knowing the third one. And finally for that, in providing all those public services and goods that I've talked about, they're going to get a tax break if they can take advantage of it. The tax break comes from, next slide please, federal tax benefits, primarily as income tax deductions, but also as estate tax benefits for their heirs. And in Texas, since we don't have an income tax, that's really the only opportunity for estate tax savings as well. Now I'll say this, is the typical scenario for rural lands. And I'm saying that because I'm making the assumption here that all rural land that's owned is probably taking advantage of the ag use or wildlife use valuation that the state of Texas allows, which means it's as low a property tax as you're going to be able to get by with in paying. If you're in the middle of town someplace and you've not had a goat, a token goat, chained to a tree, gnawing on your coastal Bermuda or whatever else in your yard, and you're not taking advantage of that ag use valuation, or God forbid, the wildlife use valuation, then, because it could be that rare goat, who knows. The point is that if you're not taking advantage of that, and a conservation easement does make sense to you and to the easement holder, you might have a very substantial property tax benefit. Because more than likely, as an urban dweller, landowner, you've been paying at the highest and best use. I love that little phrase. Highest and best use, assuming that rather than open space, someone someday is going to put a condo there or a commercial development of some type. That's the highest and best use you've been paying taxes at. If you put a conservation easement that would prevent that, you can bet you're going to significantly devalue your piece of property, which means you're going to be paying fewer property taxes. And to give you one quick example, it may not be terribly relevant because it's from the Houston area. How many of you know the city of Friendswood, south of Houston? We did a conservation easement. When I say we, I don't mean Connemara, I mean my former employer, Legacy Land Trust. We did a conservation easement in the town of Friendswood, not a very large city, south of Houston, about 35 miles, 15 acres on an important busy street, backside on the bayou, 15 acres, heavily wooded, no development of any kind. They reduced the value of that property by over 90%. They received a property tax benefit of over $22,000 a year. So it can be significant, but that's not why those people did it. Because if you're giving up $300,000 in a charitable deduction, you can bet that that land would have been worth top dollar to a developer. 15 acres divided by half acre, you know, take a look at what the benefit could have been if they were looking at it as a financial asset. Next slide, please. Landowner checklist. This is certainly not an exhaustive list. I don't intend that. What I want to do is to just get you thinking about, for those of you that own land, for those of you that know people that own land, which should be everyone in this room, these are the kinds of questions I usually begin getting people to think about. Because what's important to realize and appreciate, a conservation easement is intended to last forever. Now, there's no guarantees in life, or in the hereafter, I guess. But the point is that the conservation easement is intended to last forever. That's how seriously we take these documents. And so we want the current owner who's going to donate this with their heirs to think about the uses that you would want to reserve, the uses that you'd be willing to prohibit, and the uses that you'd be willing to have restricted to some degree. And then at times I even bring up, okay, let's say we're 100, 200 years down the road. Easement's still in place, still got to preserve this beautiful open space, and it's no longer in your family. What successor is going to look at this property and say, that's something I'd want to buy, even though I can't do anything with it. I can't make any financial benefit out of it. Try and challenge people to think about that as well. Because again, we have the long-term obligation of enforcing terms of those easements. We have the long-term forever obligation of having new and renewed relationships with every owner of that piece of property. And so we want to try and take a look at, we want to have a piece of property that's going to be preserved as open space, but also one that would be desired by somebody so that we can have a relationship with that person. Because again, private landowners are the best stewards of property. If they desire the property, they'll take care of it. Mineral rights is something that must be controlled to the extent that we know where the physical disturbance is going to occur. The Internal Revenue Service would never allow a conservation easement to be tax deductible if there was no consideration whatsoever. A person who had the mineral rights, which often is somebody else that owns the surface, could come in, obliterate the surface, and not have any responsibilities and walk away. The conservation easement in that case would have protected absolutely nothing. So that's why mineral rights are something that we need to look at, but has never yet been a problem for us to work hand in hand with. So if we could have the next slide, please. In summary, just one more slide after this. Please try and remember that there is an enabling statute in Texas. It's been on the books since 1983. And it's amazing how few people even know it exists, including real estate attorneys who are supposed to be advising their landowners, clients. But it has been around since 1983. In fact, one of the founding members of NAPA, Ned Fritz, was very involved in having that statute passed. That's one that I would challenge all of you to read, and let me know if you did happen to fall asleep before you got through with page 4. The conservation purpose is something that's very flexible in its application. And the thing to keep in mind is that the conservation purpose of an easement must provide or protect something of public value, and it doesn't mean public access. Key provisions are prohibitions, reserve rights, and restrictions. And last slide, please. People do this for very personal reasons, all of which are tied to some connection with that land. That's why they do it. They never do it for financial gain. Relationship, financial incentives, I'd mentioned those. Relationship issues, it's very important that this relationship work, and that means from the initial donor, understanding what his or her heirs want to do with the property in the future, to we get out of the heirs and into some successor, how might they be working with that holder organization, and in between just the donor and the holder considerations. What I mean by that is, again, make sure you pick an organization that's going to have similar mindset that you do about the use of land, about the kinds of open space values that you treasure as well.